Okay, good afternoon. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and encourage members to observe the measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is a statement by Dawn Swinney on the Redress for Survivors Historical Child Abuse in Care Scotland Act 2021 update. The Deputy First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Deputy First Minister John Swinney. You have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following the successful passage of the Redress for Survivors Historical Child Abuse in Care Scotland Bill on the 11th of March, the Bill received Royal Assent on the 23rd of April. I am pleased today to provide an update on the development and delivery of the Redress Scheme which will be established under this Act. First and foremost, I want to confirm that the Scottish Government remains committed to opening the Redress Scheme as quickly as possible. I have previously stated that the scheme will be operational this year, opening in December at the latest, and I want to reiterate this commitment again today. To this end, last week we laid the first set of commencement regulations to bring into force all the necessary provisions to prepare for that event. Just as the Bill was developed through engagement with survivors, our approach to implementation will continue to put survivors' needs first. We know how important it is to survivors and their families that we open the scheme for applications as soon as we possibly can. There are a number of steps we must take in order to make that possible, including setting up Redress Scotland and working with survivors to make sure the application process is as straightforward as it can be for them. Today, I will give the Chamber and, importantly, survivors an update on the progress that has been made since March. Before I do that, I would like to give an update on the advance payment scheme. The advance payment scheme has been open and making payments to elderly and terminally ill survivors for over 2 years. I am pleased to share that in the second year of the scheme, despite the challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic, a total of 219 applications were received and 166 payments were made. In total, we have now made over 600 payments to older and terminally ill survivors. We continue to take our learning from this scheme into the development of the statutory scheme to ensure that all applicants can expect the same level of service that has generated such positive feedback from survivors to date. I was asked during the committee stages of the Bill to consider whether we might change the eligibility criteria for the advance payment scheme ahead of opening the new redress scheme later this year. As I set out then, any changes to the scheme must be compatible with the exceptional nature of the powers that were used to introduce it. Having carefully considered this issue, given the temporary and specific purpose of the advance payment scheme, we think it is appropriate to leave the criteria as they are, particularly as we remain on course to open the statutory scheme on schedule. In the meantime, the temporary advance payment scheme will continue to allow elderly and terminally ill people to access financial redress up to the point the statutory scheme opens. Moving on to the preparations for the statutory scheme, significant progress has been made since March. My officials are developing and drafting the secondary legislation, which will set out some of the more technical detail on how the redress scheme and Redress Scotland will work and function. This will be laid before Parliament following the summer recess for appropriate scrutiny. Work is also underway on the statutory guidance, which will assist with the interpretation of the Act and provide further information about the processes that will underpin the scheme. Targeted engagement is taking place with survivors and others for both the secondary legislation and guidance. Feedback received through this engagement will be taken into consideration in the development of these materials. The assessment framework is a key document which was of specific interest to members during the parliamentary passage of the Bill. This framework is the document that will be used by Redress Scotland to inform decision-making on individually assessed payments in a fair and consistent way. We continue to develop the framework in consultation with clinical psychologists to ensure that we get this vital document correct. Similar to other redress schemes, this document will be published to provide applicants with an idea of how their individual circumstances may sit within the payment levels. We hope to publish this document in the autumn. As well as developing the secondary legislation, We have identified legislative provisions which are required for inclusion in a Section 104 order under the Scotland Act 1998. Discussions with the relevant UK departments about these are well progressed. This includes legislative amendments to facilitate financial contributions from charities regulated under the law of England and Wales. Engagement also continues with the relevant UK government departments and devolved administrations to ensure that benefits, social care entitlement and tax disregards are in place for those receiving a redress payment under the scheme. It is of the utmost importance that survivors are not negatively impacted by receiving a redress payment. We are working to secure appropriate disregards before any redress payments are made under the scheme. It is also of importance to a great many survivors that redress payments include contributions from the organisations that were responsible for their care at the time of the abuse. The quality of redress for many survivors comes, at least in part, in seeing their provider make a fair and meaningful contribution. I have said before, and I will say again, that it is morally imperative that our nation collectively, including all of those who played a part in the failures of the past, joins together in doing the right thing. This scheme encourages, facilitates and recognises those willing to make fair and meaningful financial contributions to redress payments to survivors. In seeking to achieve this, the Scottish Government has engaged extensively with a wide range of public and third sector organisations on the issue of participation in the scheme. A significant number of these bodies has shown real integrity in their approach to redress, and we hope to be able to reach agreements with a number of organisations in the near future. I will shortly be publishing the Fair and Meaningful Principles, which will underpin our approach to contributions. Draft heads of terms have already been provided to the principal potential contributors, and my officials are working closely with the charities regulator and others to draft comprehensive guidance for organisations considering being part of the scheme. We must ensure that survivors can have confidence in the agreements that will underpin the participation of care providers and other relevant bodies. In terms of the design and delivery of the scheme, the Scottish Government remains committed to ensuring the scheme is trauma-informed, accessible and delivered with survivors' needs at its heart. Designing how the scheme will operate involves working with survivors and survivor organisations to develop, test and improve the service, including getting feedback on draft application forms and other materials. Service design specialists are working alongside officials responsible for recruiting staff to work in the redress scheme to make sure that the scheme looks and feels as it should and has embedded within it the principles of dignity, respect and compassion. The Survivor Forum will ensure that applicants have a mechanism through which to continue to provide feedback on how the scheme is operating and make recommendations for improvements. A programme of workshops has been put in place, giving survivors the opportunity to help design the Survivor Forum, which will be in place once the redress scheme opens. Work is also underway to have support services in place for survivors when the scheme opens, including support through the application process and access to elements of non-financial redress, such as therapeutic support. The Act establishes a new independent non-departmental public body called Redress Scotland to assess applications seeking redress. Work is underway to ensure Redress Scotland has the right people, systems and processes to support its vital work. I'm delighted to announce that following an open and fair public appointments process in which survivors played a key role, I have agreed to appoint Johnny Gwynne as Chair of Redress Scotland. As many will know, Mr Gwynne is the former Deputy Chief Constable of Police Scotland and a past director of the UK National Crime Agency with responsibility for tackling child exploitation. In leading the establishment of Redress Scotland, he is resolutely committed to building the type of independent and transparent organisation which is capable of delivering justice for survivors. To do so, he will work from the outset to instil a trauma-informed culture right across the organisation. I am in no doubt that he will bring the needed leadership and empathy to this key strategic role. Recruitment is also taking place for other key roles. A campaign seeking Redress Scotland's chief executive attracted more than 40 applications, and interviews are scheduled for next week. By the end of this month, we will have launched a campaign to recruit independent panel members. These panel members will bring relevant expertise from a range of areas, for example, in the field of complex trauma. It will be these panel members who will make determinations on applications seeking redress. As I have stated many times in this chamber, some children in residential care in Scotland were failed by those entrusted to look after them, often with catastrophic results. Scotland is taking steps to face up to those failings by establishing this financial redress scheme for survivors. It is the job of this generation to recognise and, as best we can, rectify, and we are committed to doing so. I hope that this update gives the Chamber and survivors reassurance that the redress scheme is on course to open as soon as possible. It will be a scheme which offers an alternative to court. It will be non-adversarial and more accessible to survivors than the existing routes that are available. The scheme will provide elements of justice, acknowledgement and some closure for those who have been wronged in the past. We have reached an important milestone in the appointment of the Chair of Redress Scotland. I look forward to making further progress on the delivery of the scheme and providing the Chamber with further updates on this important matter in the very near future.
Thank you, Mr Swinney. The Deputy First Minister will now take questions on his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who intend to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I start by calling Jamie Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for advance sight of his statement? I'm very pleased to be filling old shoes today on this subject. These benches are still committed to working constructively towards the success of this scheme, a scheme which survivors have been waiting for a very long time. May I also congratulate, for the record, Johnny Gwynne on his appointment as Chair of Redress Scotland. The expectations on him in this role are high, and trust in it will indeed be key to his success. Can I cut to the chase, Cabinet Secretary? It is said today that extensive engagement has taken place with a wide range of organisations who would-be participants in the scheme. Can I ask, not necessarily who, but how many organisations have been in discussions with the government on contributing financially towards redress? Roughly how many of those potential organisations have indicated positively that they are willing or are likely to proceed to agreement stage on contributions? And of those who have chosen not to, or indeed who have refused to contribute, what reasons are being given for their lack of participation? And I ask this because the retention of the waiver, so controversial in our debate on this issue, was a key argument for maximising participation in the scheme. And finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, if I ask, there's little in the statement, indeed nothing, about plans for a wide-scale public awareness campaign when the scheme launches later this year. Can we be reassured today that there are such robust plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Mr Green for his contribution and his ongoing support to the work that is to be tackled here, and also for the appointment of Johnny Gwynne. I have discussed the approach that will be required in Redress Scotland with Johnny Gwynne, and as a long-serving public servant, he is aware of the importance of the characteristics of empathy, of justice, of fairness, of dignity, of compassion to be at the heart of the scheme, and I'm confident that he will ensure those are instilled in Redress Scotland. In relation to the number of organisations, we've had extensive discussions with a range of organisations. I can't give Mr Green a precise number just now, but we are going through a number of what I would describe as positive conversations with contributors about their contributions to the scheme. We will, of course, on an ongoing basis, share information about the success of those conversations to reassure the Chamber and also survivors about the degree of engagement that is being made. Lastly, on the issue of public awareness, we will undoubtedly be running a public awareness campaign. We will be starting some of that later on this month to recruit individuals for the panels that will be required. That will be the first part of the public engagement work or the public awareness work, and obviously maximising applications will be a major priority. I'm heartened by the fact that we have had so many applications in the advanced payment scheme, that our communication has been effective in reaching individuals, and that has to be ever more so in relation to the full redress scheme.
Thank you. Michael Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I also thank the Deputy First Minister for sight of his statement. We welcome that we are now on the road to a scheme for the most terrible of wrongs perpetrated against some of the most vulnerable members of our society. For so many, it has taken too long, and there can be no further delays. On my questions, when will there be details over the amount of financial redress that survivors will have access to through the scheme? I'm sure the Deputy First Minister will agree that for many survivors that will be a key moment, and can he give details in his timetable as to when that will take place? Also, that around 25% of applications to the advanced payment scheme were unsuccessful. Can the Deputy First Minister give some insight as to why such a number were rejected? And if this, what seems to be a relatively high number of unsuccessful applications, shows there is some need to widen the criteria until the full scheme is operational.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Mara for his questions. In relation to the level of financial redress that will be available to individuals, some of that detail is already set out in the face of the bill. Obviously, the further detail will relate to individual circumstances and applications that are made within the framework that has been legislated for already by Parliament. And then, obviously, there will be further information shared about the basis upon which payments will be made in the course of the next few months before the establishment formally of the scheme. In relation to the advanced payment scheme, the issues that have essentially affected the judgments around the scheme have principally been around ineligibility in relation to some of the fundamental criteria around age and about condition. Those have been the principal factors. There will be some others in relation to some of the quality of evidence, but the overwhelming majority of cases where there is any evidence available have been approved. There have been particular challenges in the last 12 months, which I think members will understand, because of the need to physically access documents, which for some organisations have quite literally been inaccessible for the last 12 months because of COVID restrictions. And we have, by exception, allowed a certain number of civil servants to be in an office environment to scrutinise documents for the purposes of the advance payment scheme. We haven't made that generally available to other civil servants, but we did for this particular scheme. So we have taken measures to try to make sure that, despite COVID, there was no interruption to the ability to meet the requirements of the advance payment scheme. As to whether there's a need to broaden the eligibility, I'm not persuaded by that argument, and the fact that we will have a scheme in place before the end of the year gives me reassurance that we can meet the expectations of survivors.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what support survivors who struggle to find or access records will be given?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we recognise the difficulties that some applicants will face in finding evidence. They will be provided with assistance from officials in sourcing or accessing records. Indeed, some of the challenges that we've been wrestling with in the course of the period of COVID have been about trying to assist individuals to access documentation held by third-party organisations as part of the process. Within the Act, there is provision which creates a criminal offence of failing to comply with a request for information which would be relevant to such an application. So there are strong aspects of legal enforcement that can be taken to make sure that this is the case. And of course, in exceptional circumstances, Redress Scotland has sufficient discretion to be able to disregard evidence requirements if they are satisfied that the case merits an award. And of course, that approach is similar to some of the characteristics of evidence taking that have been adopted in the Historic Abuse Inquiry, which has been chaired by Lady Smith and which takes, I think, a very considered approach to the gathering of evidence in this respect.
Megan Gallagher, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary referred to a campaign which has been launched to recruit independent panel members. Although he mentions that they will have a range of expertise from different areas, will they have lived experience? This is very important when it comes to survivors and making sure they have the best possible representation on the panel.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, that will be the case. And it is critical that the work of Redress Scotland and all of this activity is informed by the experience and the trauma of survivors. It has been a central requirement of the approach that we have taken. There was survivor input into the panel for the recruitment of the chair of Redress Scotland, and the recommendation that came to me had survivor endorsement, which would have been critical in my judgment on this question. So I reassure Megan Gallagher that those issues are very much at the heart of the approach that we're taking.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I can thank the Deputy First Minister on his update on this issue and the considerable amount of progress that's already been made. I'd like to also congratulate Johnny Gwynne on his appointment. I know that the expectation of survivors is palpable in this respect, and all of us will take that forward as we progress with this. But what can Johnny Gwynne and the Scottish Government do to ensure that as the procedures, processes and the people of Redress Scotland are recruited, that dignity, compassion and respect remain at the heart of all their interaction with survivors?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the inclusion of the requirements for all of the approaches in relation to this question to be founded on compassion, dignity and respect was a product of an amendment moved by Claire Adamson in the last Parliament during the parliamentary consideration of this bill, which I made clear in my closing speech to the bill proceedings, had, in my view, been the critical amendment in the whole bill process, because it had placed a requirement for those characteristics, those values, to be embedded in the construction of this scheme. And in my conversation with Johnny Gwynne, those were words which he used to me as being central to the way in which his leadership would be taken forward of Redress Scotland. And I'm confident that given the significance of the inclusion of those words in the legislation and the leadership of Johnny Gwynne, we will see those embedded in the culture and the working practices of Redress Scotland, which is critical to meet the needs of survivors.
Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Deputy First Minister, constituents I've met with are concerned to know what advice will be available and when, so that they can apply to the scheme. They have had fantastic support from Redress, Future Pathways and Birthlink, and have been told they passed the threshold for minimum payment, but they are worried about where they will get the support for what will be an incredibly traumatic, complicated and challenging process. So what financial support will be given to organisations like those I've mentioned and Wellbeing Scotland, who've played an essential role thus far in supporting advisors at survivors and will be crucial in giving them independent advice going forward?
Deputy First Minister.
I think all of the organisations that Sarah Boyack raised benefit from public funding to carry out the activity that they are doing. And one of the points which is very clear to me is there is a need for constancy of support to survivors. Survivors need to be assured that they have that access to the constancy of support in whom they trust. Now, there will obviously be specific assistance available through the channels of Redress Scotland to provide assistance as well, but I do think it is important that survivors are supported by individuals they trust and they have confidence in. So I suspect what we will, over the course of the next few months, as staff are recruited to Redress Scotland, and the staff will have to be recruited to fit in with values of compassion, dignity and respect, there will be a lot of working collaboratively with organisations that are supporting survivors to make sure that individuals are assisted to bring forward their applications and to be successful in those applications. And that has been very much the working ethos of the advance payment scheme already.
Ross Greer, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The bill enabling the establishment of Redress Scotland was amended with the support of the Government to include a review provision looking specifically at the impact that the waiver might have on the participation of both survivors and contributing organisations in the scheme. Could the Deputy First Minister perhaps expand on how this review will operate, given it's to happen across the first 18 months of the scheme being in operation?
Deputy First Minister.
This will be one of the requirements that we will build into the operating processes of Redress Scotland. We will clearly be gathering evidence from the extent of contributions that are made by organisations. That will also be supplemented by the experience of individuals and applicants, and we'll be gathering data and evidence and perspectives on the significance of the waiver and the waiver in the judgment that individuals are making. So there will be a need to, on an ongoing basis over that 18-month period, gather the evidence of the effect of the waiver and then to formulate that into a review which will be published and Parliament can of course consider. And if any action is required in the light of that review, then Parliament will be able to take that necessary action.
Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Deputy First Minister what support will be available to survivors of historical sexual abuse and care to access the redress scheme, particularly where it may be difficult for them to access or use digital technology to do so?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, we will make sure that digital considerations are not in any way a barrier to individuals applying to the scheme, so there will be hard paper copies of all application forms available. As I indicated in my answer to Sarah Boyack, there will also be support available to individuals to assist them in that process, in the gathering of information and the gathering of detail. So we will make sure that we have relevant discussion with organisations that can support us in ensuring that all of these requirements are fulfilled.
Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Natalie Dawn.
I welcome this update from the Cabinet Secretary, which shows that real progress is being made, and I also welcome the appointment of Johnny Gwynne. It's so important that we get this right, and ensuring that survivors have their voices heard is something that we all care deeply about. So I must convey the disappointment that will be felt by some survivors as a result of the decision not to lower the age limit for the advance payment scheme. But while financial redress will be an important part, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that a meaningful apology will carry much more weight for many?
Deputy First Minister.
I acknowledge the point that Beatrice Wishart makes in relation to the age threshold, but I do come back to the fact that there is a requirement for us to justify using the provisions that we have used for exceptional circumstances, and the fact that the scheme will be available in certainly most about 7 months, 6 months' time, it is, I think, a reasonable conclusion for us to arrive at. In relation to the points in connection with the implementation of the scheme, the Government will be engaging constructively with survivors on all questions. And in relation to an apology, I've tried on a number of occasions to give on behalf of the Government and the State an apology to individuals. The Government has also established the Historic Abuse Inquiry with the purpose of ensuring that the experience and the trauma of individuals who are survivors can be properly and fully acknowledged by the country is a very important contribution. I accept that there are probably no words that will properly address the suffering of individuals. But the combination of very public apologies that I have given, that the former First Minister, Jack McConnell, gave, and which the and I think the abuse inquiry will demonstrate by its powerful capturing of the testimony of individuals, I hope will help to address the very legitimate sentiments that Beatrice Wishart raises today.
Natalie Dawn to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And let me take the first opportunity I've had to welcome you to your new role.
I'd also like to thank the Deputy First Minister for the statement on what is an extremely important issue. As the Deputy First Minister touched on in the statement, it's really important that those who apply to the scheme do not then find themselves in a position where receiving a redress payment has a negative impact on their benefits or social care entitlements. Can the Deputy First Minister provide more detail on the discussions that the Scottish Government have had with the UK Government to ensure that this is not the case?
Deputy First Minister.
I'm happy to do so, and we've had extensive discussions with the UK Government, with the Department for Work and Pensions, the Department for Health and Social Care, the Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Government, about the relevant disregards that are required. We've also had discussions with HMRC. We've got the required disregards from HMRC in relation to tax entitlements and tax questions. So we're continuing our discussions with the UK Government. I'm confident that we'll secure the necessary agreements to be in place, but we're given the utmost priority to taking forward all of that dialogue.
Alexander Stewart, be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I am delighted to see that the report states that through the Survivors Forum, work is underway to have support services in place for survivors when the scheme opens, including support through the application process and access to elements of non-financial redress, such as therapeutic support. Can the Deputy First Minister give a timescale for when this will commence, and that this will include emotional and psychological support for those who require it?
Deputy First Minister.
A number of these types of services are already in place through a number of the organisations that Sarah Boyack referred to earlier on, or facilitated by those organisations such as Future Pathways, where we try to put in place interventions that will meet the needs of individuals who are trying to address trauma and to have the necessary support. So these services essentially will be continued under the umbrella of Redress Scotland, so that there is continuity of provision for individuals. And obviously, as we know from the gathering of evidence for the passage of this bill, it often takes survivors a long time and many obstacles to be able to begin to even think about this suffering. So there will be new individuals who will come forward who need to be supported, and that support will be available to them.
Christine Graham, and then the final question will be Daniel Johnson. Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Deputy First Minister, I noted your response to Mr Mara on eligibility criteria, but I want to press on with that. I have a constituent abused when he attended school as a weekday boarder. Because he returned at weekends to his home, he does not meet the eligibility criteria. Yet during those weekdays, the institution, in my view, took, to paraphrase from the legislation, decisions about his care and upbringing, and were morally responsible for his physical, social and emotional needs in the place of the parents, in which they totally failed. Is the eligibility criteria completely closed to extension of the definition of residential care?
Deputy First Minister.
I don't want to give Christine Graham a definitive answer, because it's probably not appropriate for me to give a definitive answer. I think what I would say is that it would be appropriate for Christine Graham's constituent to make necessary application to Redress Scotland in due course, and to set out the circumstances that she has recounted, because there will be every effort taken to try to address the suffering of individuals, and there may well be cases of the type that Christine Graham raises, which perhaps stretch the margins of legislation and criteria, and I assure Christine Graham that all of these will be considered carefully and sensitively by Redress Scotland.
And finally, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the statement, because the sooner we get Redress Scotland up and running, the better. But with that in mind, I'm concerned that the secondary legislation won't be passed until after recess, and also that the Chief Executive is not yet in place. Is the December date safe? And also, can the Deputy First Minister explain what will be open from December? Will that be simply applications? And can he clarify when he expects the first payments to actually be made by Redress Scotland?
Deputy First Minister.
I would put Mr Johnson's mind at rest about the timescale in relation to the Chief Executive appointment and the legislation. The Chief Executive interviews are on Monday, and there's a really fabulous range of candidates have come forward, so I'm very confident an appointment will be able to be made. I think the panel will have a difficult choice in front of it, so that's very, very encouraging. The statutory instruments, I'm confident we've got enough time to do so after the summer recess. As Mr Johnson will perhaps be aware, we have some criticism of the amount of time we're taking to consider instruments before the summer recess, so I wouldn't want to add to that in any other sphere. In relation to the applications, the organisation will be up and running and receiving applications as quickly as possible. December will be the latest. I would hope we could do it earlier. In relation to when the first applications will be processed and approved, I can't give a definitive answer other than to reassure Mr Johnson that looking at the transactional history of the advance payment scheme, it has been pretty swift in taking decisions, some of them taken in a matter of days. So I think we can be confident that this can, provided we put the necessary foundations in place, this work can be taken forward in a fashion that will provide swift responses to individuals who apply.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy First Minister. We've overrun time slightly, but given the nature of the issues raised by the statement, I thought it was important to allow all questioners an opportunity to put their questions to the Cabinet Secretary. We now move to the next item of business. I'll allow a second for the ministerial team to change positions. Can I take the opportunity again to remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the chamber and around the campus, and I ask members to adhere to these measures, including when entering and exiting the chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways for accessing your seat or for moving around the chamber.